Hello, everybody, and welcome. My name's Laura Aldington. I am the CEO of Host of Us, and I'm a board member of the Advertising Council of Australia. The Advertising Council of Australia would like to begin by acknowledging and paying our respects to the Gadigal people of the Eora Nation, who are the traditional custodians of the land from which we are broadcasting today. The Advertising Council of Australia would also like to acknowledge their culture of storytelling through art, dance and music, and we pay respect to the elders past, present and emerging on other lands throughout all communities who might be participating today. So as I said, hello everyone and thanks so much for joining us. I want to let you know that this session is being recorded and will be made available afterwards as well. As you know, because you're here, this is a session about the work behind the work. It's one of two sessions that we have run over the last couple of days. And it's really an opportunity for us to learn a bit more about what goes on behind the scenes of some of the most effective and awarded campaigns in Australia. We'll learn a bit about the process, the inspiration, and most importantly, the client relationship that went behind the NRMA campaign, as well as hear some insights from the Australian Effie database. We're going to be taking questions throughout the presentation, which we will come to at the end of the session. So please feel free to use the Q&A functionality as we go, and we'll have an opportunity to ask Fabio some questions and Caroline some questions at the end of the session. I want to introduce my co-host today, Steve Weaver. Steve is a media analyst and research expert. He's the Director of Research Insights and Education at Think TV, who are the dedicated research-driven marketing and technology development company who focus on helping the advertising and marketing community get the very best from today's multi-platform commercial TV. So I will hand over to Steve now.
Good afternoon, everyone. I am Steve Weaver from Think TV, and thanks for joining us. We are a very long-term sponsor of the Effies, and we have a great association with the Effies and the Advertising Council of Australia. The reason for it is that the objective of Think TV is very much aligned to the Effies, and that is that we want to understand and get the very best business effects out of advertising and the creative that you guys create. So to be associated with the Effies, the work behind the work, it's a great honour, and I'm really pleased to be here. I'm going to introduce you to Rob Britton, who has been working really closely with Peter Field from and Les Bennett over in the UK. A lot of the stuff that I know that you all continually read. He's been doing some great analysis on the Effies database here in Australia. Again, an association that we're proud to be aligned with. And he's going to present to you just some new insights from that database. So without further ado, here's Rob. Hope you enjoy it.
Thanks, Steve, and hello, everyone, and welcome to the sneak peek of the 2021 edition of Australian Advertising Effectiveness Rules. Peter Field and I, we're buddying up again, and today I'm going to talk through a couple of snippets from the paper. In our first paper in 2019, we looked at the question, does this apply here? And we investigated whether core marketing effectiveness principles applied here in Australia. And what the Effies database showed us is that overwhelmingly they do. And then we followed that up with another paper in June this year, which was about winning or losing in a recession. And in that paper, we put forward the case that there would be a fast recovery. We truly believed there would. And that the recession actually represented an opportunity to leap ahead. And that was really for those that were able, but also willing, to keep investing in advertising. And the reason being, because it would position them to make the most of the coming recovery. The news earlier this week was that we're now out of recession. That was announced on Wednesday. So the paper that we'll be writing this year continues on the themes that we've already started. Now, before we start looking at any data, I'm gonna kick things off with a quick poll. So if you could all get ready to click your screens and show us your responses, that'd be great. Okay, could you launch the first poll, please? Okay, so our question basically is that how do you think the Australian economy will perform in 2021? So we're just going to wait for some responses to come through. And basically, we want to understand whether we think it's going to be a strong rebound, a return to normal, or lower than normal growth. Okay, could we publish the results, please? All right, so we've got around about half of us believing that there's going to be a return to normal. Around about a quarter saying lower than normal, then about another quarter saying that they believe that there's going to be a strong rebound. And, you know, there's a famous quote that says that those who don't learn from history are doomed to repeat the same failures. And Peter and I, we remain unashamedly optimistic about the future. And we do that because history tells us that we should be confident. The COVID recession was a huge and a really rapid downturn. But history tells us that the bigger the downturn, the bigger the recovery. And on Wednesday, when they put out the quarterly growth, it was 3.3% GDP growth for the last quarter. Now, that's Australia's strongest quarterly GDP growth in the last 50 years. And remember, Victoria was in lockdown for a portion of that, and most of the state borders were still closed, but household spending surged. So Australia is digging itself out of its hole much faster than anyone had anticipated. And so really the question is, you know, as how do we make the most of the recovery? And it's why I asked the question in the poll beforehand, because, you know, optimism or your view of the future has a lot to do in terms of your confidence to invest going forwards. If businesses aren't confident, then they're not going to invest, and businesses are made of people at the end of the day. And so it appears that despite what we're seeing and hearing, you know, in terms of estimates being revised upwards, the remarkable effect of the stimulus that we've had this year, that actually a lot of people are still sitting on the fence. You know, there's many that, well, three quarters of those surveyed today, you know, you don't believe that the rebound is going to be take us back to stronger than the normal growth. So, and our publications, they're all about growth. So they're about how to best use advertising, the principles that we should employ in order to most effectively use advertising to help drive the growth of our brands. And the focus of our next publication is going to be share a voice. Okay, so before I get into this, I'm going to run one more quick poll. So it's about to pop up on your screens. Okay, could we pop up the poll, please? All right, and so really what we want to know here is, are you aware of share a voice? And do you use it? And when we say do you use it, do you actually use it to drive decisions? Knowing the number is one thing, but then knowing the number and actually using it to think about how you're planning and applying that in your planning is quite different. So keen to understand that. Okay, so we'll just give it another few seconds to get a few more responses. Okay, could you publish the results, please? Okay, so it looks as though around about half of people, you know, they're aware of it, but they're not using it. So awareness of share voice is actually pretty good. It's the vast majority of you. And around about half are saying that they're using it as well. All right, so we're going to take a slightly closer look at it now. Not going to go into it in a lot of detail, but basically share a voice. So it's a really important planning principle. And it's one that certainly in my experience has been underused. So I think we've probably got quite an educated audience that are present here today. And it was first put forward by John Philip Jones in the 90s. And basically it's a measure of a brand's advertising intensity relative to its competitors. So basically share a voice is your share or your brand share of category advertising spend. But what takes it from being an interesting data point to a really valuable planning insight is when we go a step further and we look at excess share of voice. So excess share of voice is your share of voice minus your share of market. So ESOV or excess share of voice, it can be positive or negative or neutral. And it can change quite flexibly dependent on the level of investment in the category at the category level. And it's valuable because brands with a positive ESOV are much more likely to gain market share. And that's because the intensity of their advertising is high relative to their size. And so what we found is that ESOV, it's a much more effective metric in setting and planning marketing spending. Because unlike something like marketing as a percentage of revenue, it takes into account the category context. And that's the thing where a lot of businesses, they just look at it as a percentage of revenue. And that's very much an internal focus. It's got nothing to do with the external market. It's just looking at what you're doing. So for those of you who are able to maintain your advertising spend, or God forbid, even increase it during the recession, it's likely that your ESOV will have increased, and in many categories, quite remarkably, because the overall advertising spend in your category will have declined, which should position you well for the upswing, which we're just starting to experience now. And we see the same patterns originally described by Jones in the Effies database. So brands that increase their ESOV see accelerated market share changes. But where this paper will build further on what's already known about ESOV is we're going to be reporting on its effects on business metrics beyond market share. So all of the existing literature on it currently is ESOV and market share. It doesn't actually look any broader than that, but we're going to dig into other business metrics behind that as well. And so just the last little snippet that I'm going to give you is that, you know, when we look at the overall level of business effects, we see that they are higher amongst brands that have a positive ESOV. Now, that's where we're stopping today, but the report will go into the individual metrics in more detail. But really interestingly, we're also going to be looking at the differences between different types of brands. And by that, I don't mean category. But, for example, we're going to look at the effects of ESOV and see, are they different for large brands versus smaller brands? And if so, which business metrics do we see the differences in the movement? And, you know, this is going to be important because it'll help us understand where we should be looking to understand the effects. But also critically, that informs how to manage the conversation with non-marketing stakeholders. Because when you're talking about budget, particularly if you're asking for more, you've got to be very clear about where you're looking to see the effect, where that is going to come through. And if we're able to give clear leading indicators as to where we expect it to work, where it's going to come through, where they can visibly see it, then it's a much more powerful argument for us to take to the board. Okay, so that's all for now. There'll be plenty more coming in the report, so I'm going to hand back to Steve.
Thank you, Rob. Look forward to that report and learning a little bit more about ESOV, share of voice, very important in terms of driving business growth. But I want to hand you over now to Fabio and Carolyn. They're going to talk about an amazing run of campaigns for NRMA. Truly a great campaign, and one I think we're all really keen to get under the hood of. Over to you guys, Fabio.
Thank you. How are you guys doing?
Hi, it's lovely to be here today. Shall I just go?
Go.
Are you sharing? Okay, great. Hi, and hi, Rob. Thank you for that. We're super excited to share our work today with you all. And we'll have time at the end for questions, but I guess, super proud. There's a big team of people in the background and many on today as well. But this story is really about a commitment to long-term brand building and one that we are all super proud of. It's about setting ourselves apart in a very cluttered and competitive market and about being distinctive in that space. And also it's about creative bravery. And we've really put, what are you on here? But we've put energy, thoughtfulness, and care back into a very iconic Australian brand. And one thing that I'm sort of excited to share as well is that we really do put effectiveness at the heart of everything we do, not just at the end after a campaign has run, but we put it at the heart at the very beginning throughout the work. It guides our decisions and it certainly makes our work stronger. And we've got a few principles that I thought I'd set up, and I think this is probably the most technical part of the presentation before we get into the lovely work, but I feel like it's important to share what guides us. So we really believe in growth through customer acquisition, not just through price increases. We believe in building mental availability through broad reach and reaching as many people as possible. And in doing that, to be more effective, we always put 50% of our media budget, 50% of our budget into media. We believe that creative work is by far more effective work. And to do that, you have to deliver really strong brand cues that grow distinctiveness. We believe in long and short working together, and that we put 70% into long and 30% into short. And finally, we measure what matters, and we've been really thoughtful in looking at the marketing funnel, what impacts our growth. And we look at that in quite a lot of detail every single month as we track our brand and our growth. And so that sets the bedrock for the entire marketing team and for the entire IAG business in the effect that marketing plays in growing the brand.
Yeah, and from an agency point of view, it's really, really great to have a client that gives a shit about effectiveness and cares about proving that effectiveness through the Effie Awards, because I can't tell you, look, us as an agency, we're really passionate about the awards and proving the value of advertising and the great return it can bring. But having a team like this on the other side of the fence at IAG who's as equally passionate and dedicated to that cause is incredible, and it makes all the difference when it comes to these awards and the passion, the enthusiasm for them. The pressure is really on, which I think is really, really good. But, you know, there's some clients that just don't care about proving it and adding value to the industry. But these guys really do stand apart in that sense and put a lot of effort into it. So we always try and give back as much as we can when it comes to effectiveness. So why don't we move on? We want to
raise that. Are you coming for Christmas, Grandma?
No, not this year.
Why not?
Grandpa's leg.
He can't drive. It's a long drive.
Maybe Santa can bring you for Christmas.
Okay, yeah.
Love you, Mum. Yeah, we'll speak to you tomorrow when we open the present.
All right, yep. Love you.
Walking on the rooftop. Talking of time, river eyes are glowing like the city lights. She stands on the ledge, and it looks so
okay.
You know, it's a long.
And the reason we want to show it was just for context. When we started first working together with IAG back then, before we ran back into the platform of help for the brand, we wanted to do something emotional and powerful for Christmas time, and to create almost an ad that would be an act of help in itself to encourage people to drive safely at Christmas time before we really relaunched help within the business and across the group. We didn't have much time to do it. We kind of pulled that together, I think, within a month or so. It was pretty intense at the time. But we had to do that to get the tone of the brand back where it needed to be after years of Mr. Confidence and a bit of what we saw as a bit of a misstep from the brand and where it was and where it needed to go.
I'd just add to that, I hadn't joined the team when that had dropped, and I was speaking to Brent about joining the marketing team, and all I could find, I was living in New York at the time, and all I could find was Mr. Confidence work. And I thought to myself, oh no, like, I don't think I can go and work for someone. I don't think I can work for that brand. And Brent said to me, don't worry, it's okay. We're going back to help. And I signed my contract and he sent me that spot before it had launched. And I just suddenly felt okay about my decision. I was like, this brand is going to be okay. So
I never knew that. That's
yeah,
awesome.
Yeah, okay. It got me.
Which is how we then went back to help. And one of the most, I guess, challenging things or provocative things even any agency or client can do is to go back to its past to move forward again. And I think we all got together and wanted to do the right thing by the brand and to re-embrace its roots in help and that iconic platform it used to have back in the day when it was at its absolute peak as a brand and a business. So for us, it was a no-brainer putting that back at the core of the brand. And that move away from Mr. Confidence in the blue suit, as Caroline was talking about, really helped reinvigorate the staff and help them find purpose once again. So I'll quickly take you through the launch of that campaign, which was a move on from just where we were with that grandparent spot. Distinctiveness we've been on since then to really, I think we hit a beautiful tone with the brand and where we wanted to be with this heartwarming feel, which is the complete opposite to the category, as Caroline's alluding to. But then just trying to find a even more distinctive executional way of doing it was part of where we got to with home insurance and I think really unlocked the next phase of growth for us.
Yeah, I mean, I think, you know, in hindsight, when you look back at a body of work, you look at like, oh, that part's distinctive and what we took forward. But at the time, like in all honesty, you're figuring it out and seeing what rises to the top. And it was super interesting to see that. So the impact we had on the business was obviously really good, particularly for motor insurance. And in early 2019, we were turning to home insurance because obviously our heartlands in motor and consideration for home insurance was down. So we wanted to, really, really look at that. And the other thing we looked at was also the care and warmth that was lacking in the brand that we needed to build into it. So that was sort of the brief for the monkeys.
And when you get under the skin of home insurance, it's a very, very emotional category. You know, the biggest driver of home insurance is the fact that nothing matters more than that, the feeling of security you get from your home. So from an emotional standpoint, it is just oozing with emotion. And to really engage people, we need to find a way to unlock that emotion with something quite powerful. And what we saw from people was whenever their home was under threat, whether from a bushfire, a flood, whatever it might be, people were at their most vulnerable when they lose their home or their home was under threat. So that was it's a really, really interesting place to be for a brand or to understand that as the, I guess, the foundational insight that you're talking about when it comes to home insurance, because it kind of does set up the approach you have to take to engage people with the category. But when your home is under threat or it has been destroyed or damaged, it is like a rug pull moment for customers. It is like that moment where they just don't know how to cope. It's a complete disaster and my whole life is in absolute free fall. Now, we don't want to play that free fall back literally and focus on the negative, but it's a really interesting and important contextual setting for where you're going to go with your campaign and with your brand. But the really interesting thing, I think, for us within Australia was that despite the importance of home and how critical level it was to that feeling of security people have, and, you know, when it's under threat, that rug pull moment, how severe that was, only 38% of households were, 38% of households were actually uninsured. So that's a shed load of homes in anyone's books. And it really made us really clearly acutely aware of the need to do something very different and to snap people out of their apathy with home insurance. Because, you know, even though I think households in Australia have grown by 5% since 2016, the number of uninsured homes have grown by 32%. So it's incredibly, it's an incredibly challenging category to be in, and to find a way to unlock growth, we need to really find a way of connecting people with people emotionally to unlock that growth. So it was a really good challenge actually, and one we definitely wanted to get into. But the category was a bit of a problem, wasn't it?
It was. Well, I think people. It was just the flip side of that was we needed to make homes more emotional for people, or at least be a brand that acknowledged that and had empathy for people and acknowledging the emotion that's in homes.
Does a dog with a lightsaber have empathy?
No, it doesn't. All the comedy of the category was just really, it was not helping. It was making light of situations that were really serious and really emotional for people. So it was a real clear opportunity for us to connect with people in that way.
Yeah, how the hell can you connect emotionally? When you understand the importance of home, what it means to people, how the heck does treating people or portraying customers as hapless fools instead of vulnerable people, how does that make sense, and how does that take on a deeper level of engagement than the rest of the category, you know? We understand the fact that insurance is low engagement. People don't like to think about it every day or maybe once a year when they're renewing.
Wherever.
But that's no reason to go the other way and just try and put on a comedy show and just go for the entertainment value. We need to find a way to, I guess, entertain or emotionally connect in a completely different way than the category. And we think that behaviour of the category was actually fueling even more apathy for home insurance as well. So we need to find a different way through.
And I mean, we went through the creative development with the briefing and development, and we looked at the previous work. Obviously, we reflected on where we'd been, and it was super interesting and quite inspiring, certainly for the creatives when we looked back. And as you will have seen in the spot, the koala featured. And it also featured in beautiful out of home. I hope you remember it. But it was really impactful, and people were commenting about it. And it was the highest engagement within the TV spot. So we tracked the TV, and it was the moment that people, the highest engagement. And there was a bit of an unlock there, wasn't there?
Yeah.
For planners and creators of, like, maybe there's an opportunity there. Clearly it was in the zeitgeist of culture. Remember, this is pre-bushfires.
Yeah.
It was being talked about a lot in current affairs.
Yeah, but I think your instinct as a creative agency is always to do something different and do something original. Don't necessarily executionally build on where you've been. That feels like probably too pragmatic and maybe too clever, but you always try and reinvent things and push things in a different direction. But as Caroline said, when you look at the data around it, and you know, the one criticism I guess we had of the Help Us Here We Are campaign was the montage feel to it. But the beauty of it as well was within that montage, there was an absolute gem, you know, that was hiding in plain sight. And then when you looked at the tracking, the data, it was a really, really powerful, arresting, distinctive aspect of that campaign that had huge potential to re-engage with people. I mean, we're going through a similar process at the moment. And it's just, when you look at the power of that koala and what it represents to Australians, it was pretty big, bigger than what we thought it could ever actually be. And as it turns out, they're actually the most vulnerable Australians of all. You know, no home was under greater threat. So there's a beautiful link there with the product category, what we're trying to sell. So not just from a brand point of view, but tangibly, their homes were under threat. You know, over 1,500 football fields of koala habitat was being destroyed in Australia. You know, they're facing extinction in New South Wales, but I said they were saying by 2050 due to deforestation, land clearing. And we reached an environmental tipping point pre-COVID, you know, that climate change had become one of the most concerning things for Australians. So that was, you know, that everything was lining up in a beautiful way to make koala the absolute answer. And then from a purpose point of view, more and more people are turning to brands and corporates to make the difference to the world and to contribute to social good. And it's not just up to government, because if you have to sit there and wait for ScoMo and his crew and whoever might be in government at the time to solve things for us, we're going to be waiting a hell of a long time. So they actually do look towards business as a possible way to find a way through all these big challenging situations we face. So, we ran straight into it and embraced it with both arms, didn't we?
Yeah, we did. I mean, it was we had a lot of debate about it. Can a corporate brand play in this space? How can we credibly play here? Are we looking opportunistic? Mm. You know, we really thought about it. We spoke to a lot of experts and consumers. And, I mean, it was a decision we didn't take lightly, but we all felt it was such a big opportunity. Where we landed, should I go to that slide? Was every home is worth protecting. And it was just as much, in fact, it was more about the trees than it was about the koalas, but the two together were this beautiful combination, because the trees are their homes, and that was what we needed to focus on.
And for us, it was always interesting as well that a premium or the premium insurance brand in market coming out and saying that every home is worth protecting, not just the fancy homes around the corner and just not people's homes, but taking a higher order point of view in society, we felt like a really, really powerful place for the brand to play that was beyond the category and beyond that comedy show that was happening in market. So we'll play the ad. Shall we play the ad?
Yeah.
Please play. We might have to, let me just try one more thing and then if not, we'll move on. Sorry, that's not working for us, the technology. But why don't you describe that for people?
Well, it was a beautiful story of a child. I think the one-line synopsis is a child's quest. And you know, he goes to the telegraph pole, he's not there, and then goes off to find all the equipment and takes him and releases him, but to get to the release you have to go through this which actually was space, I don't know, you talk about the spot in a bit, but where we filmed it was illegally forested land, and he releases him into the into the bush. So, and it's a lovely sort of moment of care that this young child, demonstrated for the koala.
And I think from where we were with the previous campaign of Help Us Who We Are and how he thinks that brings out the very best in Australians and also the people in RMA, we thought that little boy we call Sammy was a pretty good representation of both Australian culture at its best and also the people at NRMA as well, just chipping in to help. And the innocence of a young boy doing that as well felt like a really pure place to be. It was almost like he represents the very, very best of us. So it was a really nice fit. Again, it works within the category and home insurance. It's definitely a lateral leap from where the rest of the category is, who talk about proof points, who talk about actual people's homes, but to do it with a koala's home felt like a really interesting way to break out of the category norm.
Yeah, and to, but that's okay. I'll go really quickly and through the next slides as well, because there's a whole lot of collateral around the campaign. But what was really important, when I joined IAG, a lot of our partners, or what we call sponsorship, we sponsored the Broncos and Collingwood and these big football brands, it just doesn't feel purpose-led as partnerships. There's no shared value in that. And so this was actually the perfect opportunity to sort of shift our partners and to plant a tree for every home insurance policy. It was super important for us that we did that. And we were really careful and thoughtful in who we partnered to do that. And it's a lovely organisation called Conservation Volunteers Australia. We've got a three-year partnership with them, and they work with volunteers across Australia to regenerate habitat and bushland. We partnered with them as part of this to plant those trees. We had a whole lot of online experiences for people where they could go and see deforestation. We could bring that to life. Again, it was super important to give credibility to...
It didn't look token, did it?
No, and it really isn't token. It's been a commitment that we continue to work on, to be totally honest.
Out of home as well, Caroline, actually, there's two pieces there. The one on the left was the pole on the tree. The one on the right is is the one with the koala on the pole. And Caroline, I remember her actually calling me up saying, "I hate the pole one," I think it was. "We can't do that." And she was right in the tracking when both went to market. The tree on the left there was much better received than the koala on the pole.
They were pretty close, to be honest. Yeah. I just thought the tree was easier to get. I thought the comprehension of the tree was easier versus the flagpole.
It's much more optimistic as well, isn't it?
Yeah, a bit more caring and a bit more warmth in the tree.
Let's see if the chatbot works. A little video with no sound on this little koala chatbot as well. Why don't you talk about it?
This is really sweet. So we built a chatbot. So with Arlo, the character in the TV ad, you could go online and chat with him. We sort of thought this is just a very sweet opportunity to engage with people, really having no clue as to how this would go. But honestly, it went gangbusters beyond our wildest dreams. I think the average time was about 9 minutes. Of someone sitting there talking to Arlo, which I still find amazing.
It wasn't me.
There were over about 7,000 conversations. I think it was more than that. The engagements was about 120,000. So, that's actual kind of proper engagement, not just watching. I mean, I do think, I hate to say it, but most of the conversation was about Arlo's chlamydia. Yeah. And a whole lot of rude things, but it was still pretty funny. And then a whole lot of internal engagement. We as a team went out and planted trees with CBA and all of that. The entire organisation, we encouraged all our staff to take an annual volunteer day to get involved as well. So it really infiltrated the business. It wasn't just a flash in the pan. We had a really beautiful PR story that went that's a terrible analogy, but spread really far and wide. Our highest paid commercial actor with $25,000, which he donated to CBA, and that was beautiful too. And we signed up to the Lion Share program to donate a portion of our media spend as well.
So at every level within the campaign, we're looking to ensure that it was credible and authentic and that we couldn't be picked apart, I guess, for not actually being sincere about our approach to it, which we think is really, really important. in this day and age of radical transparency coming through. So
yeah, and while we haven't continued to talk about that in, you know, in media, we have continued to do that.
Yeah, which is great. We've got some photos of here of Barb Humphries, who's one of our creative directors here, her on the shoot with Arlo the koala. And she gave us some key facts to talk about as well from her time over there. The fact that they sleep 20 hours a day and ingest up to 1 kilo of eucalypt trees. So when your key talent sleeps from 20 hours a day, it's pretty, pretty hard. So you always need to have backup on hand. So there's three backup koalas on hand.
They're all up to 1 year old.
Yep. And in case the main talent didn't want to act, they just had to sub them in with someone else as well. So, but I think Arlo performed pretty well, the main lead. Koala in the whole thing as well.
He was gorgeous. I wasn't on the shoot, but Lizzie Stokes was there, and there was such beautiful photos coming through.
Really interestingly, in the same town while they were on the shoot, an actual koala was trapped up a telegraph pole as well. So that was quite interesting that actually happened on the day. But then I think one of the biggest lessons from this whole case study is the moment everything went to absolute hell with the bushfires last year. And I think we're just talking about it. I actually remember walking into the office and there's a plume of smoke here in the agency, or going to IGA's office, there's just smoke. And it was a really dreadful, eerie time to be in the country, right? And it just made us all think quite deeply about it. But I think with that moment, I think came an opportunity to do something. Probably as an agency person, you normally want to mess with a beautiful piece of film that was beautifully done and had a distinct purpose. But I think it was Caroline that had the idea of actually, why don't we come in and do something to the film to I guess respond to the current crisis and make a pretty bold statement off the back of it that actually captures the moment really, really well and takes it to the next level. Because the whole media as well was just littered with articles about the crisis, the Port Macquarie Hospital, all the koalas dying and suffering horrific burns. So it was a really good opportunity. And I've got to say, at first, as I said, it was a bit weird, that sacrilege messing with a piece of film. You can see it doing it out of home or in a social post and here and there, but doing it to the film was thought to be a bit nuts at the time, but it actually turned out to be a stroke of genius. So hats off to her for that.
Yeah, it was beautiful. We had our Christmas spot ready to go. So we had all the media booked and we just made a call to run this for 2 weeks. And really it was, again, a purpose-led. The first thing we did was we contacted Port Macquarie Koala Hospital and we said we wanted to support them and we wanted to put them on our TV ad. So we set up, within 36 hours, we had a signed contract with them that we would put them on our ad. And the impact of that for them, which was exactly what we wanted, I think at the time they were looking for $30,000 to get some water filters for the koalas that they were getting. They were hitting about $500,000 by the time our spot ran, and admittedly they were getting a lot of press and it was going gangbusters. But by the time they're about $9 million. The impact that that's had on what they are able to do and their breeding program that's only launched this week. It's just so fulfilling for a brand. It's ensuring the future of this beautiful animal. So that happened. And then Sam Neill came on. You guys were looking for a voiceover. And, you know, the smoke, and it was just in everyone's lives. It was, it was all we were focusing on. And he came on and he donated his fee as well to the hospital. I think everyone did. I think you guys did. Everyone
got together, involved. Right?
It was bigger than us and it felt really great as a brand to have the opportunity to do something like
this. I'm going to play it real quick. Hopefully it works.
Over the last few months, you may have seen this commercial, but in light of the recent bushfires that have devastated the east coast of Australia, we have a new message to share. NRMA Insurance is committed to helping our customers through this period, but our wildlife is also in desperate need of help, the koala in particular. which is why we have partnered with Port Macquarie Koala Hospital to help koalas today and into the future. During this difficult time, remember to look after yourselves, your family, friends, and neighbours, as well as our most vulnerable animals.
The tweak we made there at the end was it went from every home is worth protecting to every home and every life to really acknowledge the suffering of koalas and all our native animals at that time. And I've got to say, it was probably one of the proudest moments of my career to be part of that, and for the agency as well, to do something quite beautifully that was going to help actually make a difference to the lives of a lot of animals and koalas and carers out there as well that needed a helping hand. Conscious we've run out of time though, but we're going to quickly fly through just one or two slides on the impact of that. But hopefully you'll see from that the emotional power of the platform we've built and how distinctive it has become for the brand. So just real quick, obviously we wouldn't be here if policies didn't turn around, but it was the first time home policies grew in 6 years. So they were projected to continue declining, but we really flipped it around in a powerful way. So it was a massive result for the business. It was actually the biggest quarterly uplift in history of the business on record, which is incredible, and again, something we're really proud of, right? That we managed to do good, but also do good for the business as well, and everything else. Efficiency was super efficient across the board compared to one of the strongest players in the market, which was Budget Direct. Brand value, I know we had to fly through, but brand value went through the roof as well on the back of this campaign. It contributed quite a lot. We had a super positive ROI, which you can see in the paper itself as well. I think just quickly touch on this before Caroline can wrap up, but from a social point of view, the amount of positive sentiment we got from the campaign, 85% of comments were positive for the campaign, is incredible for an insurance company. Most people only talk on social media but to an insurance company when they want to complain or say something negative. So the benchmark of positive comments for an insurer in RMA is 6%. We hit 85% with this thing. So it did incredibly well. And I'll let Caroline finish on this one, which is about wrapping up the story about how it's becoming a really distinctive asset for the brand, right?
Yeah. So every 6 months, we track our distinctive assets. We also track our mental availability. But this chart shows, over time, we add the assets that we, run with into this tracker. And you can see that koala became a stronger asset than health. So in that bottom quadrant. And that was just incredible in such a short amount of time for it to become so distinctive and one that, we're paying close attention to over time. But it's an incredible story about, shifting, driving emotion into a brand in a cluttered category, really setting ourselves apart. But that warmth and care and what that means for people emotionally, that we get them, that we are empathetic to what home means to them, has been hugely successful for us.
Yeah. And that's it. That's all I've got for you today. Thank you.
Thanks, guys. Thanks, Fabio, Carolyn. That was a great presentation, and thank you all for watching through that. Can I ask, if you've got any questions, please use the Q&A tab down the bottom. And while you're typing your questions, we can already see that there's quite a few coming in. I wanted to just ask Fabio, from a planning perspective, a strategy perspective, can insurance brands grow using humour? Or is emotion better suited for this category? Quite a difference between NRMA and its competitors. Is it possible to grow using humour in this category?
Absolutely. I think there's absolute room for humour. But when the category is already so overwhelmed with humour and full of brands acting in the same way, why would you try and out-humour them? For us, it made sense to find a fresh place in the category. And when you look at the emotional drivers of insurance as well, it felt like we need to find a new way to do it and an emotional way to do it. And that heartwarming tone and having empathy as a brand felt like it could really help NRMA stand apart from the rest of the category. It's not just that, though, mate. I've got to say it's also the category is obsessed with rational proof points as well, whereas we're trying to take a higher order position within the market and approach it in a completely different way that they would hopefully never do.
Well, thank you, Caroline and Fabs, for that. I don't know if it's just end of year exhaustion. I'm sure I wasn't the only one that found myself with something in my eye through quite a bit of that comms. I guess one of the things that we often talk about in these sessions is that when you see the retrospective, it can seem quite effortless, the creation of that work and the process behind it. And obviously, most of us know from experience that good work is really easy. Putting the bushfires to one side, I'm just interested in what the biggest challenge that you guys faced in developing the strategy and the work for this campaign and how your partnership allowed you to navigate that or overcome it.
There were challenges and it wasn't seamless, but I wouldn't say it was really, really hard.
No.
Did you feel like that?
No, it wasn't hard at all. I think when you've got an idea that everyone can emotionally connect with from the get-go and believes in it, it's amazing how much easier things can be. Like if people are second guessing and aren't completely sure, it's very different, but everyone was all on the same page with it. And it was actually quite, I mean, the challenges were, is how do you make it beautiful? How do you sacrifice and make it as simple as possible for people to connect with?
How do you make it credible? Like, that was a big one for me. It's like, sure, you can talk about koalas, but like, why? I get the home insurance and that, but we've got to do something more. And, you know, I think we just, everyone rallied around that and we found a partner. We took a lot of time. We deliberated on partners of who we would work with. You know, we were really quite meticulous in that work, but it was...
That was true, though. So your internal team over there who looks after community stuff as well. It was like, we don't do koalas at the moment, but everyone just kind of banded together to find a way through to make it happen.
It's interesting. When you've got something that's so purpose-led, it does somehow feel easier.
Yeah.
Everyone was passionate. And everyone loves koalas. Yeah. It's like, there was a common cause that everyone got behind.
Everyone was passionate about. Yeah.
I guess in terms of... you know, being led, koala led, if you like. The chatbot, there's a question that's come in regarding Arlo, the chatbot. And the question is that doesn't that really remit back to humour and fun, breaking away from what you're trying to achieve? So how do you, Gabrielle asked this question, definitely acknowledging the success, but how much of a risk was that? And how did you reconcile the two there?
It wasn't a risk because the main thrust of the campaign, which the majority of people were going to see, was emotionally led and beautiful and powerful, and that's where the deeper level of engagement was. I think Arlo wasn't out there to take the piss and have a laugh. It was actually had real purpose behind it as well. It just so happened people like to get on there and have a bit of fun with it because it's a koala chatting to them. So that was fine. It wasn't in above the line comms. It wasn't the main thrust of what we were doing. It was just a really nice form of engagement.
Yeah, it wasn't, when you say humour, like it was playful versus it being comedic. I mean, people had fun with it, but it was a great engagement tool. But again, to Fabio's point, like it wasn't a mass spend, it didn't reach, but it ended up being bigger than we thought, but it was kind of a lovely, playful touch.
Yeah, I think even in the grandparents spot you saw before, there was little moments of, it's like comedy in there as well. And I think we're still trying to find our way through that across the board, right, to balance the heavy empathy and heartwarming side versus the having little light touches as well. So I think we're getting the balance right across the board, but you definitely, no one would definitely say that we're a funny brand in market. It's not our role.
Mm. Another question from the audience. Someone's asked about the fact that, you know, we're rolling into bushfire season again, and being that your category is in insurance, is your partnership strategy going to start shifting to not-for-profits that work on prevention, i.e. the sort of insurance part of it, rather than the remedy not-for-profits such as the hospital?
If anyone's familiar with our campaign that launched in first Saturday in September, it's called First Saturdays, and that's in partnership with the RFS. That was in light of the start of the bushfire season. So we are absolutely, our whole partnership strategy is looking to more purpose-led than sort of a commercial engagement with mass reach programs. So yes, we are hospitals, not that far, but more in the organisations that have sort of helpers on the ground in relation to disasters and SES. And we all have that all in place already.
Next question. A lot of research at the moment talks about people really wanting to see brand action aligning to messaging, especially in any sort of brand purpose, with a real danger of cynicism or loss of customers if they detect insincerity. How do you ensure that a purpose or emotion-driven long-term positioning doesn't become at odds with the day-to-day realities of a business like insurance?
That's a big question.
I mean, partnerships for us aren't an afterthought, I would say. I mean, in this instance, we partnered, you know, as part of the campaign, but our strategy is ongoing. Anyone on it, I know a lot of the IG folks are on today, you know, we are very purpose-led. It's ingrained. It's not sort of something we do on the side. So anything we're going to talk about, we look at sort of our corporate cons and our investments as a business. We don't just, you know, say stuff for the sake of it.
Yeah, and I think I think even when we look at some of the road safety ads we do, and even though there may not be an action attached to it, we think the communication itself is an act in itself, that it's actually delivering a safety message, or it's raising awareness of the plight of the koalas. Even if we didn't plant a tree with every policy, we still think the intent behind it is actually contributing really well to society and the cause, and especially a big corporate getting behind it as well. So we feel good about it. We think we haven't overstepped the mark, and we think if we can continue to take the right approach with the brand and do it in a way that's going to add value, we think we can continue to do it in an authentic, credible way, you know. But it is important this day and age to put your money where your mouth is as well, in some way, shape or form.
So then as a follow-up question, you've obviously got a great, a lot of fame from this imagery of koala. Do you envisage continuing using that icon?
We are considering that very...
We had a meeting yesterday about that, didn't we?
Yes, we are considering that, definitely. I think we'd be amiss to not.
Yeah, well, we could be using a Well, the lightsaber. What do you? Maybe we'll go there. We've got to work through it, obviously.
Well, speaking on that, there was a question that's come in. Were there any other runner-up ideas that didn't make the cut? Would that be one of them?
There were lots of ideas. It's interesting because what it does do, I think, from a strategic point of view, is tap into someone or something that's vulnerable, and that's a really interesting thing for an insurer to do, and to do that in a way that's quite, has empathy and is earnest as well, or at least engaging in a really powerful way. And I think you've got to get the balance right with those things. And for us, turning it into a funny comedic shit show isn't the right way to go, right?
We want it makes light of those big,
big life-changing moments, right?
Yeah.
All right. Well, I think we're out of time now. So thank you so much to all of you for joining us today for this session. It's so great to, I think we can all agree, get out of the day to day and spend a bit of time thinking about work and understanding a bit more about how such brilliant work is created. And thank you so much to Caroline and Fabio for making time in what I no doubt is a busy day to share that story with us. And many congratulations on a beautiful piece of work and an awesome relationship.
Thank you.
I think you should be very proud of. So we will leave it there and wish you all well, and thanks so much for joining us.
Bye.
Thanks, guys.
Bye.